thank you all for asking me to come and speak today. Can everybody hear me at the back? Raise your hand if you can hear me okay. Yeah? Excellent. Thanks. I tend to have a big voice. If I get too big, you have to wave more vigorously. Calm down. I'm Lionel Marks Chabry. I have a pain clinic and an addiction clinic, so I get to see both sides of the coin. I've been authorizing medical cannabis now for about 10 years, and I wanted to talk to you a little bit about the kind of questions that I get asked by patients in the pain clinic when we're discussing medical cannabis. Now, cannabis has had a bad rap over the last few decades, and I'm sure many of you remember the Nancy Reagan campaign, or Just Say No campaign. Well, in this more enlightened era, we've moved from the just say no to just say no, because people really do want to know more about medical cannabis as an option for their medical problems. So I'm here today to talk to you about some of those questions and perhaps dispel some of the myths around medical cannabis. So the first thing is, what's in cannabis? Unlike a medication that you get prescribed by your physician, it's not a single molecule. There's over 400 different substances.
Move this up a little bit for you. There we go.
Without breaking it. There's over 400 different substances in medical cannabis, and we know about relatively few of them, but the two that we do know a fair bit about now are THC, or delta-9 tetrahydrocannabinol, THC, and CBD. So if you do obtain medical cannabis from a licensed producer, they will list those two things on the label because those are the ones that seem to have the most profound medicinal effects. Now, of all of the 400 compounds here, there's really only one that's psychoactive, the one that gets you high or buzzed or stoned, and that's the delta-9 THC. The rest are not psychoactive. CBD is not psychoactive. Now, there's over 100 terpenes as well in medical cannabis. Terpenes are the chemical compounds that give each cannabis strain its particular smell and taste. They may have profound medicinal effects, but as of right now, we actually really don't know what they do apart from smell, nice or nasty, depending on your perspective. There's a theory that the terpenes actually contribute to the medicinal or beneficial effects of medical cannabis. This has been termed the entourage effect. The mixture is the medicine. But as I say, it's still early days to know for sure. I get asked this a lot. Isn't cannabis a drug? Well, absolutely. High levels of THC give you a high, happy, buzz, numb, intoxicated, stoned feeling, right? But that's not what my patients are looking for. Patients using medical cannabis for medical reasons try to avoid intoxication. My patients want to have control of their symptoms, not the loss of control that comes with intoxication. They use medical cannabis to reduce symptoms so they can remain alert and engaged, go to work, look after the kids, or go to school. Any patient who's lying around on the couch all day eating chips, smoking their medical cannabis, and watching Netflix is failing a trial of therapy. And even if they're Brad Pitt, they should be taken back off again. So what are the side effects of medical cannabis? Well, this lists the most common side effects. But it's important to realize that cannabis side effects are both initial and dose dependent. Now, what does that mean? It means you're more likely to get them the first time you try it, and the bigger the dose you use. So it's really important to start with a very small dose and only very gradually increase over time until you either get benefit or you get problematic side effects. So we say, always with medical cannabis, you start low and go slow. Now, even if you do get any of these common side effects, they usually pass away after a few hours. And not everybody gets them. Some people will. Uncommon side effects are all psychological, but even these more serious side effects also fade away after a few hours. It's also important to realize that experienced users, people who use this regularly for medical purposes, don't complain of any side effects. They rapidly develop tolerance to these side effects, or they stop using. Now, how do I use it? I've never smoked, or I've never smoked pot. How do I do this? Well, first of all, don't smoke it. It's hard to imagine a physician giving you a medication and saying, light it on fire and inhale the smoke. So we don't do that. It's a much better idea to either vaporize or take by mouth. Now, vaporizing, using any one of dozens of different vaporizers currently on the market, is very different than smoking. I'm going to go through that a little bit. First of all, when you smoke cannabis, you're lighting it on fire, and that creates a prominent smell. Unfortunately, that can attract some unwanted attention. This is a police officer, could be your grandkids too. It also produces products of combustion, the very same thing that cigarettes produce, and carbon monoxide. And you wouldn't want that stuff clogging up your lungs. And lastly, there's a huge amount of wastage involved with smoking. We'll go through that a little bit more here. Imagine you've got a marijuana cigarette or joint. Now the part at the end here that you lit on fire, well, that's burnt. That's not helping you at all. And the part just beside that is superheated to where all the medical components are broken down. It's called pyrolyzation. It's pyrolyzed. It doesn't do any good for you. It's the bit just beside that that gets vaporized and gets into you. So it's estimated that up to two-thirds of it is wasted if you light it on fire and smoke it. So don't light it on fire and smoke it. If you use a vaporizer, vaporizers have a little heating element that heats the medical cannabis up to about 180 degrees centigrade. That's enough to boil off the oils and things on the cannabis, but not enough to set it on fire. Because it's not burned, there's no products of combustion, and no smell. There's far less waste. And because nothing is burning, it's safe around home oxygen, and it's even safe in the hospital setting. There's now two hospitals in Quebec that allow patients with authorizations for medical cannabis to vaporize in their hospital room. Now, how else can you use it? Well, you can take it by mouth, either in baked goods or in pre-cooked oils already provided to you by the licensed producer. The edible oils, because they're already cooked, are ready for consumption. They come with a small dosing syringe. You pull up to start, 0.1 cc in the dosing syringe, and mix it in tea, put it in yogurt, or just drop it into your mouth. Because it's easy to use, it's more acceptable and accessible for most people. And a lot of the licensed producers now recognizing this are coming out with capsules of medical cannabis oil to make it even easier to use. Right, is cannabis legal? Well, according to the latest regulations, the access for cannabis, sorry, to cannabis for regular, blah, access to cannabis for medical purposes. This is August 2016, the latest regulations came out. And it's legal if it's authorized by a physician and if it's provided by a licensed producer. You can also apply under the new regulations to grow your own. Now, it is still illegal if you buy it on the street, from a friend, from a dispensary, from a compassion club, or from a local grow-op. So those dispensaries that are springing up, as Hugh was saying, all over Vancouver, all over Toronto, are all illegal. Now, okay, they're convenient because they're often just down the road from your house, but is it a better idea not to use them? Is it better to use a licensed producer? Well, in my mind, it is. Licensed producers have very high standards. Some even produce a pharmaceutical grade of medical cannabis, a very high quality product. They're regularly inspected by Health Canada, and they have to produce consistency. If they say the marijuana contains 12% THC and 3% CBD, it must be tested and verified. And Health Canada has done this testing and sent back batches to some licensed producers saying this doesn't meet your levels of THC and CBD. It has to be proven free of pesticides, herbicides, fungicides, and heavy metals, and it has to be dried down to less than 20% moisture, because if it's moist, it tends to grow mold. Now, the grow-up down the street, or the dispensary, because that's where they're getting their medical cannabis. They're not buying it from a licensed producer, because they're still doing something illegal, and licensed producers can't send it to them. So they are still accessing it from, I don't know, the local grow-up down the street, or Hell's Angel tribe, or whatever. They're not sourcing it legitimately. There are no standards to what they're doing. They can't come close to the level of sophistication that the licensed producers have. There's no safety checks. The only inspections they get are from the local constabulary. They're inconsistent. And unfortunately, they frequently run out of something that works. I have had patients going to compassion clubs in Toronto, and they find one strain that works fantastically for their, whatever, low back pain, insomnia, anxiety. And then they go back the next time, and there's no more of that strain, and they never see it again. So that consistency is actually important. Imagine if Advil was available some months of the year and wasn't available for the rest. That'd be pretty tough. And even if these guys say, oh, we don't use pesticides, herbicides, fungicides, there's no heavy metals in our product, how would you know? Nobody's testing it and nobody's verifying it. This comes up all the time. Isn't cannabis addicted? I don't want to get addicted. Is cannabis addictive? Well, this was actually looked into by the National Institute of Drug Abuse in the United States. And this is a body that is very anti-drug. Now remember, in the United States, marijuana is still classified as a Schedule I substance, which means it has, according to the Americans, no medicinal value and is highly addictive. That's what a Schedule I substance is. Okay, so National Institute of Drug Abuse looked at this and they said, well, it's less addictive than tobacco, heroin, cocaine, and alcohol, and about as addictive as coffee. Okay, hands up who had a coffee today?
Yes.
Bunch of addicts. Look at you all. Right.
Decaf, though.
Oh, well, cheat. What is the point in drinking decaf coffee? I just don't get it. Now, the National Institute of Drug Abuse actually produced another lovely chart where they look at social harms and personal harms. And here's cannabis down here. And in contrast that with, say, alcohol, nicotine, or commonly prescribed medications like the benzodiazepines, Valium, Ativan, oxazepam, Cirax, or codeine in Tylenol 1s, 2s, 3s, and 4s. So the risk of addiction is about 9% overall, but it's actually increased a little bit if you have a history of a substance use disorder. If you have a history of alcoholism, if you have a history of opiate use disorder, cocaine use disorder, you are at higher risk. And it's also worse if you're young. If you start using cannabis in your teens, your risk is up to 30%. But if you start after the age of 21, the risk plummets down to a little less than 3%. All right, well, how do I tell my kids? How do I tell my grandkids? I'm using pot. Well, I wish I had the perfect answer for you. If you want a perfect answer, you have to talk to this guy. I'm sure he'll tweet you one. But let's be honest, there's still a significant social stigma to voting Trump. I'm sorry, to using cannabis. Let's get rid of him. Because we're trying to overcome 100 years of misinformation and bad press. But how would you tell your kids, your grandkids, that you were on morphine, on chemotherapy, that you were suffering from depression? It's a difficult conversation to have at the best of the times, and I don't have the perfect answer for you, but things that I might suggest you say, and this is what I suggest to my patients, tell them that I'm using this to treat my pain or my headache or my fibromyalgia or whatever, and not to get high. I'm prescribed it by my doctor. And if you're interested and want to know more about it, why don't you come with me to the next appointment so that my doctor can explain a little bit more about it. Now, I get this one all the time. I get this from physicians a lot too. Isn't cannabis much stronger now than it was in the 60s? This isn't your grandma's weed. This is different. Well, yeah, it is stronger, sometimes significantly stronger, but that doesn't mean that it's necessarily worse. It's a bit of a silly argument. It's like saying wine at 14% alcohol is worse than beer at 4% alcohol. You know, wine is bad, beer is good. Well, I happen to like beer. I like wine as well, and I use less of it. And that's the same with the higher concentrations in medical cannabis. People use less, and a lot of my patients want that because it costs them less money. Now, probably the biggest question is, does cannabis help with pain, with sleep, with anxiety, with other things? Because of the complete ban on cannabis research for decades, we don't have a huge number of studies, but that is rapidly changing, and more papers are coming out in reputable journals. I was just looking at Google Scholar before I came in, just looking at the studies that have been done or reported in the literature this year. So we're only 3 months into this year, and there's already over 3,000 studies on medical cannabis that are being reported. So there's a lot of new stuff coming in. Anyway, so there have been a few reasonable studies that look at the broad picture of medical cannabis, and I'll just go over those with you. The first is by Dr. Whiting in the Journal of the American Medical Association, and Dr. Whiting did a careful analysis of cannabinoids and said there was moderate quality evidence to support the use of cannabinoids for the treatment of chronic pain and spasticity. So we have pretty good evidence for chronic pain and for spasticity. Here, Dr. Hill, also writing in the Journal of the American Medical Association, did a review of both marijuana, both for medical and psychiatric purposes, and he concluded that use of marijuana for chronic pain, neuropathic pain, and spasticity is supported by high-quality evidence. So there's a couple of good studies backing it for pain and spasticity. And lastly, Dr. Deshpande and the Canadian family physician also reviewed controlled trials of medical cannabis and decided that there was evidence for the use of low-dose medical marijuana in refractory pain. So, the evidence is moderately good for chronic pain and spasticity. Now, Dr. Barron in Headache in 2015 did an exhaustive review of every study that he could find on anybody ever trying it for anything, and he found over 50 conditions, medical and psychiatric, where there had been some report of benefit. So we have some early evidence now for promoting weight gain in people suffering from HIV, for reducing nausea in people on chemotherapy, for improving sleep disorders, including restless leg, and it has an opiate-sparing effect, which allows some people to reduce how much opiate, morphine, oxycodone, hydromorphone, how much opiate they need to use. Now, there's no good evidence yet for restless legs, dementia behavior, anxiety, depression, PTSD, glaucoma, fibromyalgia. That being said, we have to be careful not to misinterpret what the evidence means. Saying we have evidence of no benefit means we know it doesn't work. But saying that we have no evidence of benefit means we don't have the evidence. And this commonly gets mixed up. People say, oh, there's no evidence for that. Well, that's fine. That just means we need to do more studies. Now, while official randomized double-blind placebo-controlled medical trials haven't been done on a lot of cannabis, there have been some other studies done which give us some idea of where medical cannabis could be used. And one that I like to quote is from the National Pain Foundation in the United States. They called up 1,300 patients with fibromyalgia and said, what do you use that works? Now, there's three FDA medications for fibromyalgia in the United States. There's Cymbalta, Lyrica, and Savella. So how well did Cymbalta work? Well, about 8% of patients thought it was very effective. How well did Lyrica work? Well, about 10% of patients found that very effective. How well did Savella work? Also about 10%. Medical cannabis was very effective 62% of the time in this survey of people suffering from fibromyalgia. So is this hard evidence? No. Does it lead us in a direction? Yes. And I think a trial of medical cannabis in a patient suffering from fibromyalgia is a reasonable thing to do, given the relatively low risk and the potential for benefit. Now, some people seem to think that medical cannabis is a miracle medicine and can do just about anything. So we have to be a little careful not to overpromise. I took this picture of a poster in downtown Toronto last summer, and I had no idea that medical marijuana treated grinding of the teeth, hepatitis A, B, or C, and cancer. Oh, maybe it does. I don't know. We have absolutely no evidence for this. So we have to be a little careful not to overpromise. Now, does medical cannabis cause schizophrenia or psychosis? High doses of THC can cause psychotic reactions, absolutely. But does it cause schizophrenia, the disease of schizophrenia? Well, the best study I was able to find to date on this is actually an amazing bit of research. These researchers looked at over 800 boys, some of whom in their teens, some of whom smoked medical cannabis, or smoked cannabis, some of whom did not. And they followed them for 20 years. They found no increase in schizophrenia in the boys who were smoking cannabis compared to the ones who were not. That is a pretty impressive 20-year study. So from the age of 14 to the age of 34. Lastly, there's the problem of the numbers. Now, we know that cannabis use in the Western world has skyrocketed over the last 30 years, but the number of schizophrenics hasn't increased. If cannabis was causing schizophrenia, we would expect to have seen a huge jump in schizophrenia over the last 30 years. So it doesn't really go together. Okay, what about driving? Well, there's been lots of opinion about driving and cannabis, so I'll give you a sampling of that. In 1997, the British House of Lords Select Committee on Science and Technology reported that intoxication with cannabis leads to a slight impairment of psychomotor functioning. However, impairment in driving skills does not appear to be severe, even immediately after taking cannabis. Okay. How about here in Canada? The Special Senate Committee on Illegal Drugs in 2002 reported cannabis alone, particularly in low doses, has little effect on the skills involved in automobile driving. In 2014, Dr. Romano, looking at crash statistics, found that marijuana use did not contribute significantly to crash risk in fatal crashes. And the biggest study to date, the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration in the United States, looked at 3,000 accidents and 6,000 controls. They did blood tests and urine tests on everybody, and they found that the risk of a fatal crash or a non-fatal crash when there was measurable THC in the blood or urine was exactly the same as the risk of a fatal or non-fatal crash in the people who were negative for both. So that argues against the dangers of medical cannabis and driving. That being said, closed course driving studies do show that cannabis intoxication can slow you down. I like to say that alcohol makes you run the red lights and cannabis makes you stop at the green lights. But seriously, you're more likely to have an accident if you're intoxicated with anything. So if you're on any medication that can make you dopey or slow you down, whether it's blood pressure medicines, diabetes medicines, sleeping pills, antidepressants, medical cannabis, opiates, you should not get behind the wheel if you're dopey or slow. And it's really very much up to the patient to decide whether they are safe to be behind the wheel. Now, our current recommendation is not to drive within 4 hours of using or 8 hours if it makes you feel intoxicated, but imagine if we had that stipulation for every time you took a Tylenol 3 or every time you took a sleeping pill. That could be problematic for a lot of people. My personal feeling is once you have gotten to a dose where you are stable and you feel fine, then you're safe to drive. Getting to that dose, you might be a little wobbly, and that's not a good time to be driving. But once you're stable on any medication and it's not making you intoxicated, and I have patients who drive around Sudbury all day on high doses of opiates, and they are working and they are stable and they're doing well. So if they can do it, I think people on medical cannabis on a stable dose should be given the same privilege. All right, so in summary, medical cannabis has a low risk. We have a fair bit of evidence for how and where it can be used now, but a lot of studies still need to be done. Given that it's low risk with a potential for benefit, it's certainly worth a trial of therapy in a multitude of illnesses. Now, it's not for everyone, and the risk is significantly higher if you're young or you have other risk factors. Cannabis is legal if authorized by a physician and obtained from a licensed producer. And we recommend you don't smoke it. You can vaporize, or the easiest way is just take it as an oil. Always, whatever you're doing, start with a low dose and gradually increase. Now that's all I have time for today.
All right, so my name is Sarah Catterett, and I'm from Bodystream Medical Clinic. So Dr. Lionel did a great presentation just before me here. And it gets a little bit confusing, so hopefully we'll break it down for you in how to get a prescription and how to go forward from there. So answered some great questions. I'll try not to repeat myself too much. And we will do a question period at the end once again, okay? So for medical marijuana, the new regulation that just came out August of last year is the ACMPR. And prior to that was the MMAR. So there's slight variations. We won't talk too much about that. It does get confusing. But I'll cover most of what that means. So the medical regulations that are put forward, both of those legislations, basically set out the new rules for buying, growing, and selling medical marijuana. Just gonna put this here. Perfect. So so it outlines what it means for the doctors, the patients, and the commercial growers. So all the legal stuff is in there for them. Now, the legal growers, so the commercial size that are selling to patients, are called licensed producers. So we are just a clinic, so we focus on the doctor, the prescriptions, and aiding you with that. But ultimately, it would be the licensed producers that you're getting the product from. So in order to purchase medical marijuana from a producer, patients need to have a medical document. So that's what the Bodystream Clinic will help patients do. And once you have that, you would contact your licensed producer, which our clinic also helps set up for you, and you'd be ordering through your phone or online to them, and the product would be mailed to you. So the nice thing about that is that there are 39 licensed producers all over Canada, and because it's a system that's set up to mail the product to you, is that you have access to all 39. So we can find the best product for you, the best pricing, the best discounts, and work it the best way for the patient. So how the ACMPR works in traditional methods, so if you're dealing directly through your doctor per se, so there's a few issues that arise. It sounds very easy, but we just jotted down a few problems that can come up when you're talking to your doctor. So the first one is you're scheduling an appointment with your family physician. You have them fill out your medical documents. So that would be the prescription from the for the medical marijuana. So the first problem that we notice, especially in the north, is I don't have a family doctor. So people are dealing with clinics or only a specialist. Problem number two is my doctor doesn't support medical marijuana. And this is something we see all the time. There's not quite enough education out there from the College of Physicians to the doctors. So they have lots of questions. They don't have training. It's something they need to look into themselves, and that's quite difficult with their schedule. So problem three, my doctor doesn't know how to prescribe medical marijuana. So they're on board, but they don't know the lengthy process to go through. So let's say after all of that, your doctor was on board, they figured out how to give you the medical marijuana, write the prescription, great. So now they're going to submit the medical document, which is the prescription, to the license producer. So problem one is, who are the license producers? How do I get in contact with them? How am I sending them the document? And how am I ordering from them? Problem number two is that they must submit the original document. So no faxing or emailing, so it's all by mail. And this can be a lengthy process. They would need to send that out in a timely fashion. The licensed producer would need to, receive it and then process it on their end. So you're looking at a big span of time. So number three, the LP is verifying the document with the doctor. So problem one is this can take weeks or more. Like I said, it's a lengthy process. Problem two, if the doctor didn't fill it out correctly, you must go and get another one recompleted. So this is booking another appointment, seeing the doctor, and starting the whole process over again. So let's say you made it through all of that. Now you're registering with your licensed producer, you're ordering your medication, and this would be a great place to be sitting at, but hopefully months have not passed at this time, and hopefully you've only had to visit the doctor once. So it's a straightforward process is what they say, but as you can see, lots of problems come up, and fairly simple problems. So the way that BodyStream comes in is we are a medical marijuana clinic. So basically what we are is a specialist's office. Our doctors on board are knowledgeable in medical marijuana. We deal with it every day. They know how to prescribe. They know what they're talking about. And that's better to the patients as well when we know what we're doing. So the first process to working with BodyStream is getting in contact with us. So it can work three ways. Sometimes it's your doctor that first says, hey, would you like to be a medical marijuana patient? Or we've tried all forms of treatment. This is a more natural way. Is this something you'd be interested in? So they would provide you with a doctor referral. And then you would bring that referral to us, or your doctor would fax it to us, and then we would kind of get in contact with you afterwards. Now, question is, what if my doctor won't refer me? So it's not a huge deal. What we can do in our staff, we also offer services to help you gain access to your information. So we've got medical release forms that can be sent to your doctor's office, your specialist, perhaps you've had testing at the hospital, so we can help you get access to all of that kind of stuff. Or maybe you've already had copies of those. So if you want to self-refer yourself and you have copies of your MRIs, your CT scans, then you can just bring that in with you. We'll take a look at it, and it might be enough to move forward. You can also just reach out to us by email. So we have our generic email for all our locations, or our local one. And of course, you can call us at our 1-800 number or our local number, and or stop in at our office if you're looking for more of a personal touch or you need some extra pointers there. So once we would start the paperwork, so we would help you get that medical documentation, or perhaps you've had it, maybe you're a doctor referral, we also get you to complete an intake package. So that intake package is your basic information, your goals, your conditions, what are you looking for, and what are you looking for from BodyStream, from the product, all those types of things. So once we've completed that, then we get to booking you an appointment. So you would come into our location, we're now on Falconbridge Highway. and you'd be assessed by a doctor. So that's via OTN. And OTN is an Ontario telehealth network, so we don't have any doctors on site, and so it'd be like through a computer screen consultation. And what's really nice about this is that, especially in the north, we see not too many doctors on board, or, you know, still referring, they're just kind of wiping their hands of it, that most of our doctors are the Barrie, Hamilton, Toronto area, but that we have access to those doctors. So through telehealth, we can do that and we can offer those services. Now, during your appointment, the doctor will review your medical documentation. They're going to interview you to determine if you're a suitable candidate for medical marijuana. So they'll review all your intake package and that kind of stuff. The doctor is not able to diagnose any of the conditions. So this is why we require those medical documents. We're not physically there to do an assessment. So they can only prescribe based on the pre-diagnosed conditions. So this is why it's important to provide as much detail as possible when submitting either a doctor referral or the supporting medical documents. So then everything goes well, you're a good candidate, we're going to start you on a small prescription to see how that goes, and you're going to be issued a medical document. So the medical document is that document that's in place of a prescription. Contains all the information that the licensed producer needs to dispense the proper medication. So most importantly, it explains how much marijuana, in grams. It talks about THC concentration in percentages and for how long the document is valid for. So usually a 3 to 6 month period is the typical. And from this, it's kind of an open suggestion, as Dr. Lionel had said. Everybody's so different that it's basically just a guideline. And we'll talk about products and things like that with you from the licensed producers, kind of guide you on a starting product. And then it's kind of up to you to determine that worked well for me or it wasn't quite enough. Maybe I want to be seen by the doctor again and we can reassess at that point. So after you're given the medical document, we're going to go through some education. So from the moment you start at BodyStream, we're huge on education. There's lots and lots of information out there. We want to make sure you get the proper information. So when you would come in for your appointment, you would be registered with our staff. Then you're going to watch an initial video. So in that video, it's going to go through a little bit more what's going to happen that day about the product, kind of more legal stuff as well. And you will see it later today. I will play it for you there. And then you're going to get your time with the doctor. So you'll go into the office, you'll be seen for about 20-30 minutes through telehealth with our doctor. Afterwards, you'll be provided with an information package to read. So this is going to kind of answer all the questions that you have after seeing the doctor. So, great, my prescription's 1 gram a day and it's 15% THC. What does that mean to me? So this will go through that. What is THC? What does your prescription mean? And then after you've read through that, you feel a little bit more comfortable, you'll have an in-person product and registration appointment with our staff. That's typically me, so if any of you go through the process, you'll see me there. And this is where we'll go through getting you registered with the licensed producer. We're going to talk about the product, what product is the best to start, a few to trial, and going through those dried and oil products. So we'll talk more about that as well. So dried marijuana is the product that you typically find from the plant. It's straight from the plant, harvested, it's dried, and that's your marijuana. So this is the product that you would be vaporizing. We never suggest smoking still, as Dr. Lionel had said. So initially, dried marijuana is cheaper and can be purchased in 5 gram increments. And the pros of using the dried marijuana is you have quicker access to the relief. So because you're vaporizing it, the onset is a very, very quick. However, the duration period of that is less. So that 2 to 4 hours, depending on the person, of course. So we recommend vaporizing versus smoking, as your smell is reduced, protects your lungs, of course, for long-term use. Much more enjoyable experience, and you'll actually get more yield for the product. So versus smoking, that 75% of the product is burnt to ash and paper, the vaporizer will use the whole product, so you'll get the most concentrated value out of that, meaning that you don't need to use as much. The second type of product is the oil marijuana products, and this is becoming very, very popular, especially with people not wanting to inhale or they don't want to be seen doing that. So oils are product produced from the dried product. So it's where they take the dried product, they heat it up to a very, very, very high temperature, and this produces a purest content out of it. So it's getting that THC, the CBD levels. And this substance is called a resin. So they then mix that resin with a carrier oil. So you know you're talking about grapeseed, sunflower oil, which makes it ingestible. So the oils are only for ingesting. It's an oral medication, so you don't need to smoke or vaporize this product. Now, as everybody's pain is different, there is no set dosage, and this works for dried and oils as well. More specifically with oils, it can be the hardest part of going this option. So when you order from a licensed producer, you're going to get a 1 milliliter syringe. And in your information package that's provided by the clinic, you'll also find a titration chart. So on this chart, it's going to tell you day one in the evening, 0.2 milliliters. Day two in the morning, 0.2 milliliters. Then your evening, 0.2 milliliters. So it breaks it down for you to about a 16-day regimen of starting slowly and increasing slowly. And this way you can get used to taking the product and make sure there's no negative side effects and kind of introduce it to your lifestyle. And then as you increase getting more and more results, and then you would stop where you're getting the best relief. So it's very, very personalized, and it's kind of tedious to get started, but once you find that magic dosage, then you know every day I take 2 milliliters in the morning and I take 1 milliliter at night. It becomes very regimented. Yes. So,
when you get titrated.
Yes, so with the oils, it's longer the onset period, so it's not as quick as the vaporizing. It's about 30 minutes to 2 hours, depending on the person, to digest it. And it is a fat-soluble product, so if you're eating or you're putting it in a juice or you're baking with it, can speed it up as well. And the lasting relief of that is about 6 to 10 hours, depending on the person, so a lot longer relief. And something that you look at for perhaps a day use, and you can take it in the morning, you can go out during the day, you know you've taken your medication, you don't need to worry about being seen with it, it's very discreet, and then you know for the whole day you're covered with your relief. So talking more about different types of marijuana, so there's two marijuana plants, there's your indica and sativa, and those are the genetic strains. So your indica is more of a short and bushy style of plant, typically more grown indoors. So for people looking to grow their own, then this would be a more suitable option for indoor. It tells you the typical geographical origins. The effects tend to be more sedating and relaxing with full body effects. And your symptom relief most related to that would be your anxieties, insomnia, pain, muscle spasms. Now, sativas are a little bit more tall and thin, more suitable for outdoor plants, and shows you the geographical origins there. The effects tend to be more uplifting and creative with a cerebral focused effect. So you can see indica is more of your body relief and your sativa is more of your cerebral activity, uplifting, energetic, those types of things. Now symptom relief most related would be depression, ADD, fatigue, mood disorders. Now, these are the two isolated plants, but as time goes on, and of course crossbreeding will happen, and what's kind of nice about it is when we crossbreed, they're called hybrids. So with hybrids, you can get dual kind of effects with that. So if you're looking for an anti-anxiety, but you also want to treat your acute pain, then a hybrid is what we're going to be looking for to kind of get a product that covers both spectrums of issues. So you can see the sativas there break down a few anti-anxiety, antidepressant, more uplifting, increasing of energy. Your indica is more of a dominant, so more relaxing, more of a nighttime, treats acute pain, reduces nausea, increases appetite. And then we go a step further and we talk about your THC and your CBD levels. So the first step is we look at, is it a sativa, an indica, or a hybrid more of what we're looking at? Then we're going to break down the percentages of the THC and the CBD. So as you can see, this was a wheel that Dr. Lionel used as well. And you've got your delta 9s there that show your relieves pain, stimulates appetite, But as you can see, CBD is the big, big section in there. So it covers a lot of the spectrum, and that's why we like to focus on it a lot. It's also a non-psychoactive ingredient. So when you're looking at a day product, you're looking to drive or go to work or do things in the day and not be impaired, CBD is what we're looking at for sure. So it is your antibacterial, anti-inflammatory, it relieves pain, anxiety, so it covers a large, large spectrum of things, and it's very internal, so it's more body related. Okay, so once we've gone through all of this, and I know it's a lot of information, but that's what we're there to help you with and guide you through. So after this point, we've selected you a licensed producer, and we're going to send your medical document there, and within about a week or two, you'll be able to order from them. So that'll be online or over the phone, and we'll generally guide you to a product to start with. So you'll order that, trial it, and basically go from there. So now we're going to help you register with your licensed producer, and we will send your registration, we'll send your proof of income, we will send your medical documents, so we handle all of that for you. Like I said, in 1 to 2 weeks after the appointment, then you would go online or over the phone, you would place your order by yourself, and you would do your form of payment at that time. And it's delivered directly to your door, so you don't need to go out or you don't need to travel to get your medication. It'll be mailed directly to you, and the containers that those are going to come in are going to be labeled like a traditional prescription. It's going to say your doctor's name, your dosage, and what you're allowed to have on you. Licensed producers at this point still deliver license cards, so that's something else as an identifier that you would carry on you, and it would say the same types of things, your doctor, your name, prescription. It's something they're getting away from, the license cards, as it becomes more recognized. They're hoping to just go to the traditional prescription label, so cutting out that middle piece of identification, which isn't a huge deal if you know you're pulled over or something and the officer doesn't recognize the licensed producer, then they can contact that producer. The producer is going to verify that you're a patient and you have the right to order that medication. So they'll validate all of that for you. So I'm just going to show you the initial video that you would see when you come to have an appointment. It's going to go through a little bit more, and this is by our medical director, Dr. Kalyanuk. Oh, it doesn't play sound. So I'm just going to do some fact and questions quickly. So what if I'm traveling with marijuana and get caught with it on me? So you can only travel in Canada with that prescription. You cannot travel outside of it, as some of the other laws and regulations are not the same. And when you're traveling in Canada with it, as long as it's in the original container that it comes in, if you have a license card, having that identification on you and just making sure that it's in original package and proof of that. Sometimes license producers will also have an additional document that you can get them to send you that you can carry if you want to be super safe. Especially if you're flying and things like that, sometimes they just like that extra added, just to know that you can carry it on. Sometimes they require that it's put in the stowaway. So different airlines have different requirements, so we always say to contact them prior to going, just to make sure that you have everything the way it should be instead of being a surprise when you get there.
Well, the plane's flying at 34,000 and you're flying at 36,000.
So is this going to make me feel high? Can I use marijuana without feeling high? So not necessarily. Again, there's those two components in medical marijuana. There's your THC, which is more of that psychoactive head feeling, and then your CBD, which is more your body relief and anti-inflammatories. So so many of the licensed producers are starting to produce just CBD product, so you do always have access to no THC or very, very low THC, which is really important, especially for the day, or some people don't even need that, so it's not something you need to introduce to your system. Can I drive after using medical cannabis? So unfortunately at this time, the Highway Traffic Act states that you cannot operate a vehicle while under the influence. Unfortunately, marijuana still falls under this stipulation. So typically right now we say, please wait 4 hours and kind of assess from there. It is really up to the patient. If you don't feel safe after 4 hours, we're hoping that you make that call that, you know, maybe I shouldn't go out today. But what's frightening about that is all the opiate use and driving. So it's kind of an open thing right now. We recommend 4 hours for sure. And if you're using a dried product at that point, it would be out of your system. So it is something to kind of consider. Are you going out today? Do you have a THC product? Do you want to use it? How are you going to get around? So you have to kind of evaluate your own life schedule, see where that product would fit in. Do I need to inform my family doctor? So perhaps you referred yourself to Body Stream, you had your medical documents, and you came and did the process with us. No, you did not need to inform your family doctor. However, it is always a good idea to let them know what you're, you know, trying and how you're being treated. Our doctor is only there to help you with medical marijuana, so we don't help with any other healthcare needs or physical assessments. We can't refer you to different specialists, so it's still really, really good to have your family doctor and keep them informed if you feel that they're going to be supportive or not say any negative things to you. Something else that always comes up is I'm a veteran, and I've heard that Veterans Affairs will cover my medical marijuana. Yes. We have found that Veterans Affairs will cover most of the costs associated with medical marijuana, also including the purchase of a vaporizer, which is a medical device. So you can contact us and let us know, hey, I'm a veteran, and we will deal with all that paperwork with Veterans Affairs through your licensed producer and get them directly billing Veterans Affairs for those costs. Does insurance cover the cost of my prescription for marijuana? Unfortunately, at this point, we haven't seen any insurances cover the product. It's something that's changing very, very rapidly right now, so we are hoping. We always suggest that you contact your insurance company, ask some questions, kind of see what their breakdown of is that. And like I said, it's changing all the time, so we're very, very hopeful for that. How much does the marijuana cost from a licensed producer? So the price can vary, of course, depending on the producer and the strain. Of course, dried versus oils will have different costs. So typically you can expect to pay between $5 to $12 per gram, $12 per gram being the very high end of that spectrum. So some producers will also offer discounts for people with limited and lower incomes. So that's called your compassionate pricing programs. And our office can help you get registered for those as well. So sometimes you look at 10%, 20%, 30% discounts. And those are all different from licensed producer to licensed producer. It's something that they create for themselves. So we will definitely help you with that. Just let us know that, hey, I'm on a fixed income or I'm trying to watch my finances. We can also help you select the best producer. So of course, talking about the dried versus oils, those discounts, and getting you the best bang for your buck. How do I use marijuana? I don't smoke. So of course, the recommended way for using marijuana is with the vaporizer. It's very, very different than smoking. Of course, you still inhale, but it's a vapor. So there's no heat, barely any taste. And it's very smooth. It's basically just breathing in through your mouth and it's in your lungs and you're good to go. Another great option is, of course, the oils instead of the dry, and it can cut out the inhaling completely. So it would just be an oral medication. How long does the process typically take with Body Stream? So once we have everything completed, all the paperwork and the medical documents, then we'll be able to provide you typically an appointment within 2 weeks or less. So because we have about 18 doctors on our service that rotate through, we have lots of opening for people. And once you come in for your appointment, 2 to 3 weeks afterwards at most, you'll be registered with your appointment and you'll be well on your way to trialing your product. Your second appointment, which would be called your reassessment appointment, would be the appointment after your initial, of course, and that can be anywhere from a month, 2 months, or 3 months, depending on how we're seeing. If you're trying the oils, perhaps we want to see you in a month to make sure that you're taking that appropriately, follow up with you to see how it's going. Of course, if you're very, very naive or new to medical marijuana, we want to make sure that it's going okay and there's no issues in those first months. So sometimes you'll see, to get started, about a 2-month prescription. That way we can follow up with you for sure. What kind of supporting medical documents are we looking for? So if you have a doctor referral, then that's all we need. We get that done right away. If your doctor isn't on board, or perhaps you have your own medical documents, then we're looking for a note from your general practitioner, anything dating your diagnosis, the results of the investigation, other treatments attempted, any copies of specialist notes, your MRI, CT, ultrasound, MRI reports. So quite a few things. We don't take blood work or medication lists, although if you have those things, they do help add to your case. So we definitely will still take a copy of those. Is there a fee associated with dealing with BodyStream versus through, you know, your general practitioner? No, there are no fees associated with gaining access to your medical document. We are fully covered by OHIP, and the only cost through our service that will fall to the patient is the product. So once you're registered with that producer, you're ordering the product and you're paying them directly for that. So those are the only costs, and your reassessments are covered by OHIP, everything like that. Okay? Now, is there any questions? Yes.
I want to know, are there any symptoms of withdrawal?
Withdrawal. No, there isn't, which is really nice. And if it's something you don't enjoy taking, say, you know, this wasn't really for me, or I didn't like the way it made my body feel, or maybe it was too much THC, as soon as you stop taking it, within the next 4 hours, or, you know, even 12 hours at the most, it's going to be out of your system. So yeah, it's very fast acting that way. Yes. Yeah.
I know I have to go to the my specialist to get the form filled out and mail myself. You said you do it by video conference.
Yes. So the way that we have, because it's something that we deal with every day, this is our strictly only business, we've set up with the licensed producers, we're in communications with them all the time, so we always know what's going on with them, we're going on with Health Canada, so we've set up a secure fax, and they've allowed our doctors to do digital signatures. So we do that all online, and then it would be faxed to the licensed producer. So it's a lot quicker than mailing it, of course. Yes.
I've been using medical marijuana now for a couple of months. If you need to change your license to use another one, do you have to go through the whole doctor's thing all over again, or can documents be moved down to another license?
Okay, so the question was about switching license producers. So typically with us, we like to stick with the producer until you're reassessed. So if that's a month or 2 months or 3 months, you would come in, you'd be issued a new medical document. At that time, we can look at a new producer. Now, if you're dealing with your doctor, it's going to be a little bit more difficult. And they can kind of cancel with one licensed producer and fax it to the other. Or they could see you again, write a new prescription and fax it to the new producers. I know family doctors are kind of lenient of that because it's not their full-time business. They've got other patients and things. But typically with us, it would be those three-month periods that you could switch or you could stay with the producer. Something else that we've also started is because it is a natural product, it's not like a pharmaceutical. So it's, you know, not a bazillion Advil or available at the snap of my fingers. We've got to wait for it to grow and then harvest and dry or produce the oils. So what we've started doing is we've been splitting prescriptions. So if you have 1 gram a day, and that's your prescription, you can decide to have 2 licensed producers. So we'll send 1 medical document to one for 0.5 grams a day and the other to another producer for 1.5 grams a day. So you'll still be allowed the same dosage, however you'll have access to 2 producers and 2 product variations basically. So if one is low, then you can still get your product and you're not left kind of waiting around for that. And licensed producers as well, because it is a natural product and we've also just started this splitting prescriptions, and perhaps you're only with 1 producer, then you would have the availability and the service to contact our clinic and we would see what we could do for you. We for sure want you to be able to get the product.
Thank you very much.
Thank
Sarah.
You.
Thank you to everyone. First of all, we have a little something.
Oh, thank you.